The views expressed by the speakers of Camma Plan podcasts are those of the speakers only and may not reflect those of Camma, its members, or employees. Camma does not guarantee the accuracy of information provided by these speakers. Professional advisors should be consulted before implementing any options presented. Camma absolutely does not endorse or recommend any individual or organization, including the speakers. Camma, its members, and employees do not accept liability for losses and/or damages arising from errors or omissions within, reliance upon, or any use of the information provided by the speakers. Individuals are strongly encouraged by Camma to conduct their own due diligence before making any investment choices. Camma does not act as, nor offer the services of, an investment advisor, CPA, realtor, or attorney. If tax, legal, accounting, investment, or other similar expert assistance is required, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to The Road to Financial Freedom, a podcast that allows experts to share their stories and secrets to unlocking their financial independence. This podcast is brought to you by Camma Plan, a self-directed IRA administrator in Ambler, Pennsylvania, that is focused on educating investors with different ways to grow their retirement savings faster through alternative investments. And of course, we are continuing to record our podcast remotely. I'm Jess Jones, Camma Plan team member and podcast host. Our guest this week is the president and CEO of Red Hawk Property Group, LLC, and Welliott Investment Group, LLC, two vertically integrated nationwide private equity investment firms that manage active investments across multiple platforms and target acquisitions of single-family, multifamily, and opportunistic residential assets. After serving in the California National Guard, she moved to Philadelphia and attended Temple University School of Medicine to train in family medicine. And this San Francisco native is also a passionate, dedicated educator and leader who speaks frequently at public events, business seminars, and real estate conferences nationally in order to teach investors about the power of passive income and how diversification of your investments will set you, your family, your estate, and your futures all up for success. So please join me in giving Dr. Patricia Redhawk a warm welcome on our podcast. Hi, Patricia.
Good morning, Jess. How are you?
I'm good. How are you? Thank you so much.
It's delightful to finally see you. I'm a big Camma Plan fan. So,
well, I'm a big fan of yours as well. We had the opportunity to meet in person mm-hmm. way back when. So mm-hmm. I'm excited to get to see you again in this setting. Yeah. So I'm mm-hmm. and I'm excited to get to actually talk to you and dig into your background and discuss everything. So let's jump right in. Can you start by telling me some more about your background, like where you grew up, went to school, studied? I find it's always interesting when I ask this question to all of our guests mm-hmm. because all of the things that you do in your background, I firmly believe, you know, come back up in Absolutely. Your future and mean something. Everything happens for a reason. Like I find that I wouldn't be sitting here doing this if I didn't do musicals in high school. You know
what I mean? No, I totally agree. And yeah. having done musicals in high school myself. As you mentioned, I grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area. I lived there to my early 30s. I put myself through college in working full time and then also used the California Army National Guard and subsequently the GI Bill to help pay for college. And that worked out pretty well. I served a tour of duty in the Middle East during the war. Not my favorite part, but you know, all a part of my story. And as you mentioned, I moved to Philadelphia to attend Temple University School of Medicine and then ultimately trained in family medicine. I lived out in Philadelphia for about 22 years or so. And my family and I, just last summer, we executed a pandemic move cross country and relocated ourselves to the Eugene, Oregon community, which I could not be happier about. It's just beautiful out here. I'm thrilled to be back on the West Coast, which is where I belong, and so I'm really delighted. But all that also necessitated sort of a pivot. So, you know, I was acquiring and using what's commonly known now as the BRRRR strategy. That's the buy, rehab, rent, refinance, repeat method to acquire mm-hmm. Single family homes. So I have a portfolio of homes on outside the Philadelphia area. But when I moved to the West Coast, it's kind of a different part in the market cycle, and it's a different market out here. So I am sort of pivoted and now focusing on sort of larger projects and also some new development stuff down here, small multifamily kind of stuff out here. But to circle back in the very beginning, I learned how to fix and flip houses from the inside out. Because mm-hmm. I was acting as the carpenter at the time and helping other investors fix and flip their houses. And so I knew the numbers, I understood the concepts, and they sort of brought me along to help them figure out which houses were worth it and which were not. And I learned how to flip houses in the San Jose, Silicon Valley, Almaden Valley area. Those lessons really served me well. In 2010, I left clinical medicine. In fact, I don't even carry an active medical license anymore, so I've sort of burned the boats there. has worked out very well for me, and I've really capitalized on that, my early experiences, as I build my portfolio now. And I would have to say, I'm one of those folks that, the thing about that going to medical school does is it, and every physician would tell you this, that is that we have an obligation to maintain our professional edge, as it were. And so there, mm-hmm. We have to focus on maintaining a current fund of knowledge that's active and up to date. So, everybody's heard that they have to take like continuing education hours, whether you're a realtor or an attorney or a nurse or a physician, doesn't matter, dentist. Lots of professionals need to take additional training hours every year, and I'm a big fan of doing that. So even though that's obviously not required in the real estate investment realm, I still do. I probably consume 10 to 12 hours of educational material a week. So wow. I'm someone who is a huge believer in education, I assimilate it into my own active working fund of knowledge, and it helps me because I'm able to draw on both the broad and deep then kind of well of information. So, but all that's to say, here I am, and I'm happy to be talking with you today.
Wow. Thank you for sharing all of that. I mean, I think it's extremely interesting how you describe that professional edge and mm-hmm. the work ethic that I'm sure has carried over into how you approach real estate investing. Mm-hmm. And I think that, the fact that you started with fixes and flips in the carpentry setting is really interesting. Like, how did you even get involved in that? Was that when you were first introduced to real estate investing, or what was that moment where you were first introduced to this as a lucrative career?
Yeah, well, I got to tell you, it certainly didn't feel like it at the time. I was in my early 20s. I was actually working as a carpenter for another contractor, and a dentist approached me as in sort of a side hustle. He said, do you do side work? And I said, sure. And what do you got? And he said, well, some friends of mine and I are fixing this house down in San Jose, but the contractor dropped the ball. Can you come just help us fix the rest of it? I said, sure, I can do that. And so it was this guy and a couple friends of his, and they had been flipping houses, but they're professionals. Like, somebody was a dentist and somebody else did something else. I don't know. But, these mm-hmm. guys who had W-2 jobs, but they just needed somebody who was smart and trustworthy and, knew how to set cabinets and knew how to, pop in a window and that kind of thing. I was like, sure, I can help do that. And so I'm actually pretty good at design. And so I could help them with subsequent projects. I helped them sort of figure out, hey, this is a better use of space here. Let's kind of shift this around. Let's take down this non-load-bearing wall and kind of open it up in a different way. And so it worked out really well. And then over time, as I sort of shared my thoughts and ideas with them, they brought me in more on the discussions about going to see houses and say, we're thinking about buying this house. What are your thoughts about how we could sort of trick it out? And so it was nice. And it did not feel like... it felt like I was at the time staying in my lane. I knew enough about design to be helpful. I know how to set cabinets and kind of, do some residential remodeling. And so I was able to add value to that conversation. And in the process of just sort of organically doing this kind of a project over time, I started to learn about real estate investing from them. So it became more mm-hmm. of a two-way conversation. So, fast forward then in 2010, when I'm thinking, okay, medicine is not a good fit for me. I miss my patients and I love practicing medicine, but frankly, American healthcare system is broken. And I was unwilling to spend mm-hmm. the best 20, 25 years of my life putting energy into that. And I decided, there's something about the job and then there's the career, and they're not the same thing.
So when I like that distinction.
Exactly. So the mm-hmm. job was going to be a lot more challenging and sort of soul-sucking in a way that I was unwilling to participate in. So when I was sort of circling back, I did some consulting for a while and some small project work to kind of figure out what the next steps would be. And I had been thinking about this time when I worked in fix and flips. And I'm like, yeah, actually, I had a good time doing that. And it wasn't such a stretch. My father was a real estate broker for many years, and then was also a real estate appraiser in Sonoma County. And so I have people in my family who worked in real estate, but were never investors. However, it wasn't such a, you know, real estate as an industry wasn't so far afield. For me, and that worked out well. And so I just kind of connected the dots for myself. I remembered what a great time I had doing that kind of work. And I, like, you know, I flipped dozens of houses, but I would never want to do that job again, actually.
Right.
My carpentry background and my design expertise really came to play, and it served me well. And fixing and flipping houses is a great way for folks to grow kind of large chunks of cash, et cetera. That's, what they're interested in doing. But I'm interested in more long, safe, consistent returns and really utilizing a more passive income model. And also I'm in my mid-50s. I don't want to be swinging a hammer anymore. That's the last thing I want to do. So I don't do that anymore. I actively participate in the design process because I like that. I'm able to produce really lovely houses as a result. But for the most part, I'm not doing any fix and flips anymore or house. And I do sort of larger passive income models now, but still using the residential business model plan.
Got it. No, thank you for sharing. And I think you raise an excellent point. It's something you had to experience in order to know this isn't exactly what I want to do, whether it's flipping or having that experience and having that moment or epiphany, whatever you want to call it, where you said, you know, there's the job, and the job is going to be the best years of my life. It's going to be soul sucking. There's the career. Is there anything that you find, whether from that or serving in the National Guard in California, that comes up still as you're a manager and an investor, or things that you're like, wow, that actually, like, I'm glad that I'm no longer involved with it so much so, but I'm glad that I was able to pick up these skills.
Sure. So I'm going to kind of reframe your question into be sort of what from my previous experience, what skills or experiences do I bring to bear on my current investor career? And I would say that, actually, one of the things that probably helps me most is having been a physician, because here's the deal, Jess, all business is about relationship. It doesn't even matter what industry you're in, but by virtue of having been a physician and having had conversations with everybody, my patients and their family members, et cetera, I would have to say that my ability to have conversations and exchange information and start to understand someone else's situation, whether it be a motivated seller or a potential investor, you know, in one of my syndications or fund projects, or even if it's just fellow investors and we're looking to see, you know, sort of what synergy might exist between us in terms of potentially working together. All those things really come about, I think, in large part from my ability to have poignant and important conversations. And lots of that I'm an extrovert by nature, but certainly I think being in medical school and speaking with patients has helped me have a more sort of information-driven kind of conversation. So I have to say,
yes.
Yeah.
No, I completely agree with you on that point, too, because I'm an introverted person, which people always are quick to tell me, no, you're not, but I am. And I have a ton of experience doing improv. And for me, like, that comes up so much, whether we're in these conversations or I'm in a meeting, and I can, because I have that intuition that I feel like an introvert has to have, or you have to be able to pick up when you know what your scene partner is about to say next, or that sort of thing too. So I think it's those little skills that I'm like, oh, this is a communication thing that's coming up however many years later from a silly sketch I did with a friend 5 years ago, you know, like, so it's, I think it's really interesting stuff. And I'm glad that you bring that up. Thank you for being so candid about it too. And you mentioned too, at the very beginning, that you still continue with your education and consume anywhere from 10 to 12 hours a day or a week, I'm sorry, continuing education. How do you seek out that information? Sure. Are there any specific tools or anything that you use that you rely on?
Sort of outline how I do that. Well, you know, like every business professional or and busy working mom and et cetera, my time is pretty tight. But I'll tell you, to sort of also piggyback on your last question, one of the things I learned in medical school was specifically how I learned. So I didn't even learn it during college. And there are lots of different ways, and this will resonate with many of your listeners. You know, either you're a strong audio processor, right? So you can lecture learner. That's how you gain, mm-hmm. one of the main ways you gain information. Or you read about it, and so you pick it up via reading, or you workshop it, so you're the person who needs to work with your hands or somehow process it in a different way, or a pictorial learner. You learn through pictures and graphs, that kind of thing. So there's lots of different ways that people learn, and one of the things I realized mm-hmm. from medical school is that I suck at lecture learning. I'm the worst lecture learner, which I can't
even believe. I learned that, too, about myself as well.
It's crazy. So, you know, it started mm-hmm. with me that I got all the way through college, did well enough in college to get into medical school. And then just, you know, medical school has been described as sort of a drinking from a fire hose, and just fell, and it absolutely is. And I realized mm-hmm. I'm a really bad lecture learner. So I had to quickly sort of identify what my other strengths are. So I will tell you, and having said that, it's a bit ironic, I get a lot of information via podcasts because I'm able to sort of double dip when I'm in the car. I can listen to a podcast. And so that's one of the ways I listen to probably about 90 minutes to 2 hours worth of podcast education every day. And that's part of how mm-hmm. I get to that 10, 12 hours a week. I always have two or three books that I'm actively reading. That's one of the main ways. So the way that I use podcasts is podcasts allow me to cover a breadth of information. There are probably about 15 podcasts that I routinely listen to, kind of on a rotating schedule, and that allows me to I can listen to it on a more superficial level. I'm not learning it to really ingest it, but what's so helpful right. is the podcast interviews might have written a book, or they might have a blog post, or I can go and listen to other interviews that they've done with other people as well. So it's right. a way for me to really kind of drill down on somebody's particular idea or story that I find helpful. So I can go back to it in different ways. So mm-hmm. I find that the podcasts end up being sort of the color brochure, as it were. And then if I want more information, I'll go to the computer and I'll do some reading and drill down a little deeper. But I find that to be sort of a great way for me to learn about new ideas in the marketplace, to consider sort of the macroeconomics of our market and global market, as well as our nation, as well as, you know, my local market, and that helps. So oftentimes the podcasts give me the first glimpse, and then I'll go mm-hmm. and I'll dig deeper on a particular topic or a particular person, and I'll typically go online and start drilling down. And like I say, I always and often the podcasts give me these great book title suggestions. So mm-hmm. I've kind of got five on my bedside table, two or three I'm sort of actively reading now. And that's how I cover a lot of ground that way. So it's very helpful.
That's really helpful, especially from a time management standpoint too, because I think that was missing from my question. And as you were saying it, I was like, yeah, like how do you consume 10 to 12 hours of information a week? And I think that that's a great way. I mean, it's how I keep up on culture, comedy. I listen to my podcasts too, like things that interest me and enjoy me, mm-hmm. Or that I enjoy. And I find that I can do that while I'm working, or like you said, driving. There's something physical to it too, because I'm learning. I'm a bit more hands-on when it comes to learning as well. So mm-hmm. for me, I can put something tactile to being able to consume this information as well. So I think that that's a really great method that I feel like I haven't heard enough about in this industry. So mm-hmm. I appreciate you kind of outlining how you're able to do that while also making effective use of your time.
Yeah.
So your companies, let's talk a bit more about them. Yeah. Red Hawk Property Group and Wellington Investment Group. And I know you've got, you know, other private equity funds, mm-hmm. all these things going on too. So can you give me an overview of everything you're managing and investing and doing right now?
Sure. So the Wellington Investment Group is a Pennsylvania-based LLC. And that is a business that I used when I first started off in investing, really back in 2016. And it has a small portfolio of single-family residential houses out there. That's great. It's almost like a set it and forget it. I've got great tenants. I like them a lot. Mm-hmm. And I'm lucky. I'm one of those landlords that didn't skip a single rental payment, and nor were they late. So, but I, you know, that that's kind of a fluke. There are plenty of landlords who are good landlords and have good tenants, but pandemic really kind of pulled the rug out from everyone. But the Wareham Investment Group is an East Coast based residential portfolio company. Then when I moved to Oregon last year, I started the Red Hawk Property Group, and it's an Oregon-based, really Pacific Northwest-based LLC, and it's the company that I'm actively working now. And we seek to acquire, residential properties, and kind of like most folks, we look to add doors. Small multifamily, single family homes, et cetera. We're also engaged in doing a little new development. There's a possibility to, it's in the preliminary stages of starting a small 10 or 12 unit multifamily building, which I think would be great. That'd be great fun. So I'm starting to kind of put the numbers to that and see what happens. But the really kind of a big, exciting project I'm working on is I put together a private equity real estate fund, which I mentioned to you, I just recently launched a couple weeks ago. And that is focusing on acquiring homes in newer homes, single family residential again, up in the Portland, Oregon market, which you recognize to be one of the big tech cities. It's kind of the Silicon Highway between Silicon Valley and north all the way through Portland and into Seattle.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So a lot of Silicon Valley companies are moving to different places, and certainly up and down the West Coast as well. And our project is, kind of came out of the pandemic in a sense, because I thought I study the economy all the time, and I was very concerned with the amount of money the Fed was printing, and very concerned about our nation's balance sheets and what was going to happen in the future. And it doesn't matter whether you're a Keynesian economist or you come out of the Australian school. The reality is we are way far outside the box at this point, and we're doing things that both Department of Treasury and the Federal Reserve, tactics and techniques that have never been used before. And, I'm the first to say I have never even taken an econ class. But I think we all know, when you supply and demand, when you're printing a lot of money, you should be very concerned about the purchasing power of that dollar over time. So as a result, I decided, and again, I crafted my newest project, my newest private equity fund during pandemic, and I wanted to focus on safe, consistent returns. So I'm, I used to play semi-pro softball, and anybody who played ball will tell you that you win games not with home runs, but with base hits. And so I would consider this sort of a base hit kind of project, because I'm going down to focus on the things that people need. So they need good quality, safe, clean, secure housing. But in a place like Portland, you have a unique community. You have a large tech community, and you also have a large number of, for instance, millennials who work in that field. So if you've got somebody who's a millennial working in tech, and they're making six figures, but they're not interested in buying a house because that's just not where they are in their life. They want really a kind of a quality living experience. And so that's what we're providing. So we're essentially buying new homes, and they're all beautifully furnished in the common areas, but we rent them out by the room. And so we are renting these to basically affluent tech professionals. And so if it's a five-bedroom house, I have five leases. Basically we rent the room, and it's all inclusive. So utilities and maid service and soap and paper products and, everything is all included in one price. And so although it's higher than the average rent would be if they had, say, a one bedroom apartment, but the reality is in a one bedroom apartment, you would have to unbundle all those services, and it ends up being, right. If you live with us, you get, you're living in a brand new house. You've got other kind of cool folks that you live with, but it's also going to be about $400 cheaper than if you were to do it on your own. So right. It's kind of an interesting model. Rent by the room has been around for a long time in sort of different permutations, as it will. But Portland is a really fantastic opportunity and great community to utilize this particular technique. So yes, I'm building a small portfolio of single family homes, but I'm not renting it to families. I'm renting it out by the room to these affluent millennial tech professionals, and so that's really the thesis of my private equity real estate fund now. Very exciting time.
Yeah, definitely. It sounds extremely exciting, and I'm excited to see, you know, how it turns out and how it keeps going and, you know, continue making those base hits. Yeah. So the thing that also interests me too about your response, Patricia, is the fact that, you know, you're able to look at a situation. Okay, there was, this is the pandemic. This is where the millennial Silicon Valley migration is headed. Mm-hmm. These are all of these different factors that I have to take into consideration mm-hmm. when thinking about how to build these investment portfolios or these funds. And I think that it's definitely a skill that seems like it must have been acquired over time. Mm-hmm. So how do you look at the situation and decide which factors to take into consideration as you're building your personal strategies for investment portfolios?
Sure. So I'm a big believer in reverse engineering. So mm-hmm. Basically what I start off with is a conversation with myself. It's like, okay, where am I going and what do I need to achieve? And again, this came out of being in the pandemic. And I wanted to capitalize on a need that was ongoing and rather permanent. So the idea that people need a place to live is always going to, you know, be the case. And so, you know, that still takes me to single family. I was a little concerned. Let me pause part of my answer. You know, if you're investing in multifamily, multifamily syndication or a multifamily fund, you're probably typically doing a value add situation, which is where you're going to go in, you're going to decrease the operating expenses, and you're going to increase rents over time and probably do a lot of physical plant upgrades, et cetera, with the idea that you can increase the net operating income to increase the value of this apartment building. And then a couple years in the future, you refinance and then cash everyone out or sell it at this increased value. That's a fairly typical kind of apartment building play. But my concern in considering something like that was I didn't know where the economy was going to be in a few years. And so it felt like I needed to play it much more conservatively. And I thought, well, you know, you still have people who need quality places to live. But I want tenants whose jobs are well-paying and who have a need to be in that community. And when it comes drill down to it, it made perfect sense. You know, you've got tech professionals who are typically single or young in their career or you know, might be partnered, but typically are not married and off to the suburbs to buy a house. And, you know, there has been a migration as a result of the pandemic for folks moving out of the city core and into the suburbs. But those people aren't mm-hmm. single or even young couples. Those are typically young families or, you know, that have children and they need to be in a different situation. They realize because of the pandemic and working from home and remotely, they don't need to be in the city core anymore. So we are seeing mm-hmm. that demographic shift. And so I follow those numbers particularly. But there are engineers and other folks associated with tech that need to remain in the city core and want to, because that's where the vibrant social life is for them. Mm-hmm. And so my job is to provide a really cost-effective, kind of brilliant solution to that kind of community. These are folks who are making great money and they want a quality experience. And so I'm buying these homes in the really cool neighborhoods where I'm sure you and folks your age would love to live. And like I say, they're beautifully furnished in the common areas. There's typically a home gym and, like I say, maid service and, you know, paper products and soaps and things like that, that we supply as a part of the sort of, you know, all in rent price. And I think it's and again, focusing on safe, consistent returns, the cash flow is steady. And it's a great ongoing opportunity for both my tenants and for my investors and myself. So
definitely. And that brings me to another question that mm-hmm. comes up based on conversations, you know, we've had, things I've heard from, you know, the beliefs that you've built about investing as you've gone through your career. Can you kind of explain and break down the difference between what defensive investing versus offensive investments are? So I want to hear some more about it. And could you define, you know, what those mean to you?
Yeah. So came out of a conversation that you and I had a couple of weeks ago in preparation for this particular interview. And I talked about that I have a very, I think I have a very different and a very kind of straightforward manner in which I construct my investment portfolio? And so this is one of the topics that I'm often invited to speak on, because I'm not a certified financial planner. I'm not an accountant or anything like that. I'm not an attorney. I'm a physician who's a full-time real estate investor. But there are some, I'm able to sort of keep it real. I don't come with a lot of industry jargon. I'll tell people, I know this is true. The Kama Plan clients and the other folks who will be listening, they're pretty smart investors. If they already know to use a self-directed retirement account or other kind of account, then they already have a leg up on most folks. Having said that, I think it's still incumbent upon us to be paying attention to how we construct our portfolio and, again, kind of reverse engineer. So the way that I do that when I consider it is, all of us have had that experience where we sit down with a financial planner and we get the pie chart, right? So the pie chart with the different colors. And it doesn't matter, everybody has different size, pie slices on it, depending on your age and your risk tolerance and asset allocation and things like that. Big kind of fancy words. Well, I keep it much simpler than that. My feeling is my portfolio is crafted in a particular way. I have assets in my portfolio that I deem as defensive and assets in my portfolio that I deem as offensive. Let's start with the defensive first, because I have fewer of those and it's easier to understand. It's an easy place to start. So here's what I'd say. So first of all, what do I define as when I would use these defensive assets? I use the defensive assets if the economy collapses. So the things that I have on the defensive side of my portfolio house are things I intend to use if the economy totally collapses. We get another war going on, or we have just total economic implosion. I expect these assets in my defensive side to keep me and my family fed and alive, and allows me to gain traction and move forward. So on the defensive side, I hold precious metals, gold, silver, etc. Now, these are actual metals, so I don't own, for instance, mining stocks for these precious metals. I actually own the precious metals themselves in a non-bank depository. That's fine. And I use those because I might need actual gold coin. I might need actual silver coin or something like that if the economy tanks. I don't ever expect them necessarily to be worth more than they are now, but I do expect them to hold their value if kind of the crap hits the fan. I can dip into that if I need to. The other thing that I have on the defensive side is I'm a big believer in the sort of infinite banking concept, which there's a man named Nelson Nash and who used whole life insurance policies, high cash value life insurance policies in order to endeavor families to become their own banks. That's a very, I would say, advanced topic, and so I won't go into that, and folks can certainly delve into it if they want to. It's known as the infinite banking idea. But the other piece of the defensive pie that I have is I also own crypto and cryptocurrencies. And crypto as a tactic has been a recent addition to my portfolio just this year. And the thing that I will say is that the crypto is the only thing I hold both on the defensive and on the offensive side. I expect the coins that I'm invested in, I hold them. I'm not trading, so I'm not buying and selling stuff. These are assets that I hold that I expect to hold value if kind of crap hits the fan. So that's pretty much the defense of precious metals and crypto, and also the infinite banking system I consider as part of the defensive side of my assets. But now let's go over to the offensive side. What do I expect of my offensive assets? These are things that I expect to do one of three things. One is I expect them to throw off money now. I call that now money. That's quite literally the money that I use every month. I pay for preschool fees and gasoline and bananas and movie night and pizza out and insurance and blah, blah, blah. So that's quite literally the money that I live on every month. So I have assets in my portfolio that throw off income to me every month. That's my now money bucket. I also have assets on the offensive side that throw off later money. I define later money as retirement for me and college education for my kids, etc. So I have later money. And then I also, I have legacy money. Lots of folks don't do this, and you know, it's neither here nor there whether they do or not, but I want to set up an ongoing financial foundation that supports my descendants as well. I have now money, later money, and legacy money. But for the most part, let's just focus on now money and later money. And on the offensive side of my house, things that throw off money for now and for later, and this is circling back to the self-directed accounts, later being, you know, my college for the kids, retirement for myself, et cetera. And those are assets I hold in my self-directed accounts. Properties, single family homes, rents, you know, kind of go back in. I have some properties that I hold that throw off now money, and I live off those every month. And then I also have other assets that I own within my accounts that throw off later money, right? So I'm not using that now, it just goes right back into my accounts. So I own rental homes and add to that portfolio on an ongoing basis. I also am a private money lender. And so I loan out our funds to other investors who are doing fix and flips or rehabs, or you know, they're engaged in something else. So being a private money lender is a very lucrative and ongoing basis for good income. I highly recommend that for folks who have self-directed accounts. And then also I buy and sell notes. So usually I sell on occasion. These are notes that, you know, a mom and pop sold a house and they're getting monthly payments and they expected to do that for 15, 20 years or something, or maybe even 30, but life circumstances pop up and they need to get out from underneath that now. So they need the money now rather than waiting, you know, to the end of the note to get paid. And so I can acquire those notes on a discount. And then, you know, the borrowers are solid. These are people who are living in the house and you know, there's been no issue with their payment. It's just that the people who own the note need the money and they can't wait 15 years. So I can pick up that mortgage note, and that's nice, steady, you know, income into my offensive side of my portfolio as well. So let me see. So I own properties on the offensive side. I'm a private money lender on the offensive side. And also I have notes and carry notes. And that provides income as well on the offensive side. So those are things that I expect to do well and continue to do well. And you know, I'll drill down a little bit and say this too, that in terms of the real estate investments, I'm fairly diversified in that realm. You know, one of the things that people need to figure out right away is, are they sort of the first decision tree is, are you a cash flow investor or are you an appreciation investor? And I will say that I'm a cash flow investor. So I'm invested in some markets in the U.S. in which I really don't expect large appreciation to happen over time. So I might own a house for 10, 15, 20, or even 30 years. And unlike someplace on the West Coast where you probably would expect a huge amount of appreciation, I don't. These other houses that I own, I don't care if they ever increase in value. They're likely not ever going to lose value, but they cash flow the day that I buy them, which means that the tenant's rent covers more than the cost of ownership and throw off positive cash flow every month. So that's kind of how I lay that all out.
Well, thank you. I mean, I took a lot of notes when we first had this conversation a few weeks ago. That's what I'm pulling up now as well. But I just want to commend you on the fact that, like, I feel as though I've been working at this company for however many years, and I have the ability to actually sit and learn as I'm actively working with clients, working with my team, this and that. But sometimes stuff like this still evades me. You know what I mean? I heard you say offensive and defensive at first, and I was like, okay, well, what does that actually look like? Mm-hmm. How is that tangibly broken down? And for me to make the connection of, oh yeah, of course, because rent comes in every month. Right. So you can put that away for now and for later and for your life. Yeah. Like, those sorts of things make a ton of sense. Oh, that's why you invest in precious metals. Yes, of course. So I really appreciate you kind of the way you break things down. And I really think that based on the fact that you focus so much on how you can infuse your investor education yourself into your investor education for others, I think that it's an extremely interesting approach that you've developed. So is there anything that has, like, come up for you in terms of how you approach your investor education tactics, that these cycles and these types of investing and your experiences with them have contributed to?
Well, I'll say one of the things that I try to do is maintain constant education, right? So we've already talked about that. I'm consuming a good number of hours every week doing education. But I initially, I'd have to say that I really focused my reading specifically and my study really specifically about single family and that kind of investment. But as I gained a sense of competence about that, then I start to ask other questions. And so, for instance, I'm quite familiar with how you do a value add play for a large multifamily project. That, you know, and there are plenty of reasons why multifamily is a great asset class to be in, and plenty of reasons why it's not. Plenty of reasons why single family is great. Plenty of reasons why it's not. You know, right. And it's not that right or wrong or this or that. It really speaks to what's your passion. My personal feeling is, this is maybe my personal mission statement is, whatever projects I'm involved in, it has to be fun and it has to be profitable, or at the very least, it has to pay for itself. And it has to help people. And that's really it. Right. It's like three bases. So circling back to sort of the education piece of it is I'm constantly drilling down and learning more depthful information on specific topics that I need to further my career as well. But I always keep an eye to the broader market as well. So. So I have to say, folks need to really endeavor to do both. But understanding that the folks who will be listening to this podcast are, again, you know, they're smarter than an average bear. They know that self-directed accounts exist, and they're engaged in that. And I have plenty of investors I work with as well who bring me their self-directed accounts and say, hey, I want to invest this with you. How do you think I should do this? Or I want to create a portfolio like yours. Can you help me do that? And I have that conversation all the time. But the fact that I'm well read in the space, and I have both a broad understanding of a number of different asset classes, as well as some deep understanding in the few that I work in consistently, is part of how I'm able to have that conversation with other investors. I hope that answered your question. It's kind of
Yes, it does. So how has that contributed to now you're developing a course? Is this the first course you've developed, or how has that contributed to developing an actual educational course out of that rather than just networking and speaking at events, which have their educational benefit, of course, but a course is a new endeavor.
Indeed. And thanks for circling back to that. What I have found is I spend money every year on courses or coaching to learn specific things that I want to learn. And I encourage everybody to do that. I have sort of an annual budget I use, and I keep that in mind. And so when I need to learn something specific, I have no problem kind of stroking a check for a course or a class that's going to very directly impact the work that I do. And that's been super helpful. I will tell you, though, that in the process of learning about syndications and learning about private equity real estate funds in order to put together my own fund, there was sort of no one source I could go to. My education came from a number of different sources, and I was able to, at this point, aggregate a huge body of knowledge from putting together my own fund, talking to attorneys, talking to other investors, et cetera. So one of the things I that came out of that is, as I speak to other groups and would talk about my experience, investors would come up to me and like, look, I'm a manager for the phone company. I'm an anesthesiologist, or I'm a nurse, and I work at a dialysis center. I'm not going to stop working my job, but I know that I need to invest in real estate. But I don't want to be a landlord. How can I do that, but without tenants and trash and toilets and termites and things like that? And it really then inevitably the conversation gets around to passive income. And I talk to folks about what syndications are, what private equity real estate funds are, like the one that I have and just launched, and explain sort of their role in one's portfolio. portfolio in terms of generating passive income. And really what came out of that, people were saying, well, you know, do you do coaching or this and that, the other? And finally I got to the point, it's like, wow, I should actually sit down and put together a course for people. And that's quite literally what I'm doing now. I'm rolling it out. I've got a small group that's going to be beta testing it in the second half of July 2021, which is when we're recording this. And I think we'll be going live with the course in August 1 of 2021. And the idea is that people need to understand what syndications are, what private equity real estate funds are, but more importantly, how to do the due diligence and evaluate them. Because this is not the situation where you're going to take a look at a house, should I buy it, should I not? Or an apartment building, should I buy it or should I not? And there are plenty of checklists and things that you can go through to do due diligence on that single project. The kind of due diligence you want to do on a syndication or a private equity fund is very different, and it's much more nuanced, and it really requires a kind of rigor and a whole different kind of fund of knowledge to bring to bear. So you're not only evaluating the sponsor, the operator, the person who's driving the bus on it, but you're also evaluating their team and their processes. Who is managing the administration part of it? How do you evaluate the actual fund offering or syndication offering itself? What are the fees involved? What's a waterfall? How are things constructed? And then on top of that, it's like, what is the asset class that they're investing in, and does that make sense? So you have to sort of evaluate kind of a number of different things in order to decide if an offering is an appropriate investment vehicle for you. And there are plenty of investment vehicles out there that, again, are sort of swinging for the fences, and that's fine. They have their purpose. Mine tend to focus on, again, safe, consistent returns. This is bread and butter real estate investing. I can have a conversation with anybody across the kitchen table and explain exactly what I'm doing, and it doesn't require lots of charts and graphs. It's very straightforward, and I think that a lot of investors really appreciate that. So I developed a course to help people kind of, you know, find the diamonds among the dogs, as it were. There are a lot of things to understand about this level of passive income investing, understanding how to evaluate sponsors, how to do due diligence on the asset class, how to evaluate the market and the market cycle, and specifically the construction of the offering itself, the private placement memorandum, and sort of all the SEC paperwork that goes with that. And so there are a lot of moving pieces to it. So I put together this course to help folks who frankly needed to know more in order to take the next step passive investing. And I hope it's helpful. And I'm always open to feedback. And so, you know, for the folks who are getting involved on the front end of the course, I'm offering some one-on-one and one-on small group coaching and Q&A as a result of their going through the course, so that I can make sure that it's super effective, that I'm answering the questions they need to have answered, and that they understand the educational material that's provided and can really use it as they start to put together their own offensive and defensive side of their portfolios. So hopefully it helps.
Right. No, that sounds incredibly helpful. Even just from where I sit, knowing full well that I'm nowhere near being an accredited investor, and I do want to talk to you about, you know, types of investors and things like that. I'm nowhere near that. I'm not moving probably to Portland to be in Silicon Valley on the pipeline anytime soon. But I think it's extremely interesting because you lay out such an excellent point that it's like, you know, you shouldn't have to seek out so many different sources in order to get the answers you want, and then maybe miss something along the way, like that crucial due diligence, you know. And there's so much to be said about this is designed by someone who's been in this situation before, who knows the ins and outs, who's accepting feedback, not some algorithm created program by like the big masterminds in a office that you'll never see or interact with. So I think that it's incredible. And it's very personal as well. So I wish you the best of luck with that as well. So I do want to talk about, you know, you also brought up an interesting point in our previous conversation as we were prepping for this podcast too, the difference between an accredited and sophisticated investor. Mm-hmm. I learned a ton from our conversation on that. So I would love for you to share that with listeners.
Sure. And frankly, I didn't know this myself until I got into investing back in 2016. Frankly, my first real estate investment was actually even before the first house investment property I ever bought was in 2006, I believe. So it was actually before the downturn. And so I managed to hang on to it. And one of the things I would say to people who are looking to invest in syndications and funds is just that. Make sure that your sponsor, operator, the person who's driving the bus, in my case, it's me, make sure that they have full cycle experience. So I started investing before the 2008 crash, and I kept my properties through that. And those are the folks who typically have some gray hair, but those are the folks who have weathered some very impressive market forces. And so all things being equal, I think that those are really the sponsors that bring the most experience in leadership to any project. So that's one of the things I would say. But to circle back to definitions of investors, and people don't realize, I think for the most part, that that it's not a level playing field. So I think it's as a result of the Great Depression back in the 1920s. I'm not exactly sure. It might have been sooner than that. But the IRS defined a category of investor known as accredited investor. An accredited investor is, by their definition, sort of the varsity level investor. Define the varsity level investor as someone who you can qualify one of two ways. Either one, you have a net worth of $1 million. So you have $1 million net worth minus your primary home. So let's say you're one of those folks who your parents passed away, you inherited a bunch, or you've done well in your investments, whether, but you have a net worth of $1 million, not including your primary home. That's the boom, then you're an accredited investor. The other way you can be an accredited investor, and this is actually a lot of the investors I work with, because I'm an MD, you know, a lot of my investors are healthcare professionals, doctors, dentists, etc. And the other way that you can be designated an accredited investor is if you, as a married person, make $300,000 a year, or as a single person, $200,000. You've done that for the last 2 years. You anticipate doing so in the next couple of years. So basically, via either your net worth is $1 million minus your primary home, or you're a high income earner, $200,000 for singles and $300,000 for married. That also can qualify you to be, quote, an accredited investor. And once you have achieved that designation, there are a whole host of investment opportunities that open up that are not available to you before then. So, you know, if this is new information for many of you, you can start to, you know, just get online and start to research accredited investor opportunities and see what pops up. Because what ends up happening is that there are many investments that are only open to accredited investors. You'll learn about them and et cetera. But if you're not an accredited investor, you cannot invest in those. And so how do you do that? Well, your CPA can attest to that. There are certainly a number of companies that go through a verification process with you to attest to that and make you an accredited investor. And then you're able to access different kinds of investments that you can't before then. There's another level of investor known as a sophisticated investor. And the sophisticated investor, it's not as well and clearly defined as the accredited investor status. A sophisticated investor is a lot vague. The IRS has not been very specific about this at all, nor has the SEC. And basically, if you have bought and sold stock, or you have bought and sold real estate investing or something like that, if you've done some investing before, even if it's stock market investing, you may qualify to be a sophisticated investor. Like I say, that's kind of the hand-waving portion. It's a lot vaguer and not well-defined as the accredited investor status, but folks can be sophisticated investors. And so many investment opportunities are accredited investor only. For instance, the Portland fund that I'm doing now is an accredited investor only. However, On my website, I've got other opportunities that are both sophisticated and accredited investors, and so anybody can show up and participate. So it really depends on where folks are, but that's one of the things that if you haven't known about that before, you should understand that. And if you are an accredited investor and you didn't realize or hadn't had that conversation with anyone before, there might be a whole bunch of investments that you could invest in that you don't necessarily know about now if you didn't know about accredited investor status. So something to keep in mind.
Thank you. Yeah, no, I think it's a really helpful breakdown too, because I feel like I hear accredited investor all the time, but where does everybody else fall? Yes. What category do they fall into? And you know, everybody had to start somewhere to become accredited. So I think that being able to break it down in that way, and also being able to allow investors to approach you in that way, as I think extremely valuable for you as the person, you know, driving the truck, steering the ship, driving the motorcycle, riding. That leads me to one, like, a fun question I do have for you as we kind of wind down, Patricia. On the topic of time management that you'd spoken about before with education, you're involved with so many things. You're raising your children. You are swimming a mile a day, which I read and was like, good for you. Riding motorcycles, racing sailboats, and more. So how are you how do you find balance in your life, basically, with all these activities on top of teaching, managing your investments? What's been the thing that's gotten you through it all?
I got to say, kind of two things. One is that once I hit the point where my passive income was enough to support me on a monthly basis, and which is the goal, right? It's like, wouldn't it be great if your monthly income from your passive investments took care of your monthly expenses? Once you hit there, you're effectively retired. You have financial independence, and that's a fantastic place to be.
Right.
Sort of once I hit that point, you know, I love my work. I love being a real estate investor. I see opportunity everywhere. And, you know, I have projects both domestic, locally where I live, as well as some international projects coming down the pipeline for next year. So I see opportunity everywhere. And that's a lot of fun for me. So I love to work. But I will say this, that one of the things I need to do on a very consistent basis is unplug, because that's when I get the creative juices flowing. So time management, this is an ongoing challenge for me, but I will say this, I kind of have a used time blocking. So for the most part, I have a 4-year-old who dictates a lot of my schedule. So, you know, I'll pick him up from school at about 5 o'clock, 4:35. We go home and there's dinner with the family. He goes to bed at about 7:30, and I'll often actually do work or reading or writing specifically in the evening. I don't do it 7 days a week, but that's I get quiet work done there, close functioning, close scrutiny kind of work done, and that's helpful. And I don't say no to opportunities during the day to meet with other investors and folks. I'm a Rotarian and a proud member of the Rotary Club, and so my current chapter is very busy. And so I just really I spend time and I time block. So I do podcast interviews in the morning, meet with other investors and do research as it comes up, et cetera. So I try to use the morning for the kind of one-on-one stuff. And then in the afternoon for kind of catching up on loose ends and that kind of thing. And then in the evenings is when I do sort of my quieter work. So there are themes to different sections of my day, although it's fairly loose, and I do like that. And you know, potential investors, I love having those conversations. So I often have just one-on-one Zoom conversations. And this might be folks who don't end up investing with me. I mean, you know, as a private equity real estate fund sponsor, one of the things I have to do is make sure that my investment vehicle is an appropriate fit for their asset allocation, risk tolerance, et cetera. And I have to make sure it's a good fit. There are plenty of folks out there who are happy to take your money. And I can't say yes to every dollar that's offered to me. I want to make sure it's a good fit. That always requires a one-on-one conversation. And so what I have found is, with those kinds of conversations, that investors, even if the current project isn't a good fit for them now, I you know, we've warmed the friendship sort of landscape between us, and they'll often circle back and say, hey, I have different money. I'm interested in doing that other thing you were talked about. And so I think that, you know, time blocking for investor conversations, for new opportunities and podcast interviews and teaching. And then, again, like I say, I always have time for family but time blocking is really key for me. It took me a long time to get here. And I like kind of a loose schedule, so I can go long in the swimming pool in the morning an hour and a half in the afternoon to go ride or something like that. So
that's great. And I selfishly ask those questions too sometimes to my guests, because I always kind of want to know, how do you do it all for myself, as I think about, well, how do I get better at time blocking? And I think you hit the nail on the head. It just has to come with time, no pun intended, but it does have to come with time and with the experience, and then, you know, getting to a point where you can start to have the mental space to make those time blocks and things like that. So
that's exactly right.
Well, thank you so much for sharing this and for sharing so much of the information that you were able to share over the course of this hour with me and with the listeners. I'm really excited to for people to pick up this podcast and think, well, hey, where can I reach Patricia next? One quick key question that I do ask everybody before we get into, you know, where can people reach you, is what would you say are your keys to building wealth and unlocking financial freedom? So this does not have to be financial, but for you, Patricia Redhawk, what is something that has informed the way that you look at your unique definition of success?
Sure. So my unique definition of success is really grows out of financial freedom, right? So as soon as the monthly passive income equals or exceeds my monthly expenses, boom, then I'm off the clock. I can do whatever I want. But I think getting there is really as a result of two things. One is relationships. And so, you know, there's a phrase that says that your net worth is your net work. And then I circle back to the idea that all business is about relationships. So it's really been the quality of relationships that I'm able to strike up with folks. And I've always believed that if I'm authentic in my voice, transparent about who I am and what I do, that that will resonate with the people it needs to resonate with. So I'm not overly concerned about impressing anybody. My feeling is I do. I'm happy to share in the journey and the information along the way. And if folks want to invest alongside me, that's great. So I think the relationship is relationship building is definitely one of the things that has helped me get to this place. And of course, the other thing is ongoing education. So there aren't many people who consume as much information as I do, but I think that's absolutely key. It opens me up to new ideas, new strategies, new techniques, new markets, and new paradigms and ways of looking at building real wealth. And again, circling back to what success means to me and how can I set myself and my family up now, later, and for the future.
Thank you so much. I appreciated your authenticity throughout this conversation too. I can feel it even, you know, across the country through a Zoom screen. So thank you so much for taking the time today, Patricia, to be so candid with us and share these tools. I feel like I'm already a bit more financially literate, and now I want to keep seeking stuff out. So for you, where can people, anybody listening to this who want to get in touch with you or learn more, how can people get in touch with you? Websites, social medias, anything like that that listeners can use?
Sure, I would send them to learn more. To two of my websites. One is patriciaredhawkmd.com. And I imagine you'll put that in the show notes. And also they could go to redhawkfunds.com to see my current and some of my past, even in future projects. And Red Hawk is, you know, it's a Native American name, red like the color, hawk like the birds, two words. So patriciaredhawkmd.com and redhawkfunds.com are two things you could take a look at. And if you send an email to me through those websites, it comes to my desk. I will see it. So there aren't a lot of layers between myself and my investors. So
awesome. Well, thank you so much again. I really appreciated our time together. Thank you. So everybody listening, please be on the lookout for more Kama Plan events that feature Dr. Patricia Redhawk. But until then, thank you everyone for joining us this week on the Road to Financial Freedom. Be sure to tune in next week to hear more from our experts who have paved their roads to financial freedom, or call Kama Plan today to learn how you can start to take control of your future wealth. Thank you everyone, and have a great day. Thank you all for tuning into our podcast.
We truly hope that you're enjoying your ride along the road to financial freedom so far. If you like what you've heard and learned, or if you want to hear more about certain topics that we may have already covered or have yet to cover, please subscribe, rate, and leave us a review. We would love to hear any feedback from you so that we may continue to make our podcast the best that it can be for you, our listeners. Thanks again, everyone. And remember, tune in next week to The Road to Financial Freedom.